So today I'm going to open this thing up. Probably give the pots some DeOxIT treatment. Just to at least brush off the front, which is pretty dusty. Brush out the exterior a bit. Just give it the first over.
Inside of Marantz Receiver before, so I don't know, for example, that they use orange can caps and black can caps and gray can caps and even purple ones. It's not unusual at all to find different brands of capacitors within a receiver. They probably got the parts the same way I would, by figuring out what part they needed and what parts they could get that were good enough for as little as they could get away with paying for. And that's what anybody does. Right? Unless you have brand and even line loyalty for some reason. Some people stick to one brand. I generally prefer either Rubicon or Elna. I used to prefer Nichicon. Got somewhat disillusioned with Nichicon because their values always seem to run low. Rubicons are made in Japan, so that's partly why I go with those. The Elna Silmic 2s are just really bang on spec, and within batches especially real consistent with one another. They're supposed to have other properties that make them good for audio. I don't know. They're capacitors. But in terms of specs, they're really good. I think that's an Elna, Nippon Kimikon. I would be a bit surprised if the difference in brands had to do with specs like high ripple current, low ESR, that kind of thing, rather than simply being decent capacitors that were cheaper for a particular value and voltage and so on. Anyway, it's predictably filthy inside. I mean, it's dusty, right? There's one like sticky, icky bit, and I don't know what the hell that was. But mainly it's just dusty, like you'd expect from a receiver that was built in the late 70s. I mean, hell, even if it had been opened and at some point and serviced, still had plenty more time to accumulate lots of dust. It's always a little bit interesting for me to speculate why somebody gave this up. So here's my speculation: that they're getting intermittency in one of the channels. They don't know what to do about it. And it's old. I can't find anybody to repair it, not for reasonable money. So I get a new one and donate the old one. Not really appreciating, let's just be honest, the value to collectors of Marantz receivers. Maybe they do, they just don't really care, and they just want to give to charity. That could be too, as this did make some money for charity. But I suspect that whoever got rid of this didn't really know what they had. And without such people, where would people like me be? And that's how I got my Sensui receiver. I got it from somebody who didn't know what they had. I didn't know what they had at the time either. It wasn't until years later that I figured out what I had, what I had gotten for like $5. I just got a pair of Genesis 1 speakers today, the first Genesis 1, the Roman numeral one, made in the late 70s. My first good speakers were Genesis 1's, the Arabic numeral one, from the early 80s. And I got rid of those for practically nothing at a yard sale because the foam had disintegrated. And I just didn't know that that was something that could be fixed, you know, without too awfully much trouble. And by that time, Genesis Physics had gone out of business. They had a lifetime warranty, but they went out of business in 1987. And I didn't find at that time, and I don't know if it even existed yet, because we're talking quite a long time ago now, didn't know about or hadn't found Human Speakers, which specializes in serving EPI and Genesis speakers. So yeah, I've been that guy who got rid of something that had something relatively superficially wrong with it that was relatively straightforward to fix, but just didn't know how to deal with it or want to deal with it, and somebody got a great deal. Wow, that is one crusty IC right there. I don't know if it's potted. Must be potted. It's got sticky all over it. It's like, surely that's not just dust. I generally use paint brushes to clean out these interiors. Good paintbrush does a good job of getting the dust out. Not a perfect job, but pretty good job. So this is the tuner board that I'm cleaning off right now. I know that not because I looked in the manual, but because it's got the air gap capacitor that is used to tune in the frequencies. It's also got a few integrated circuit chips on it, which is not terribly unusual, but I wouldn't expect to see, say, on a preamp or amplifier board of this era. So I generally do try to give equipment a decent once-over like this before I start any kind of real repair or restoration work. And then as I remove things and so on, then that gives me further opportunities to clean things up so that by the time it gets put back together, it's usually pretty clean. Of course, the face and the knobs I'll just take upstairs and clean in the sink with dish soap. It also gives me a chance to really look at every part of it as I'm cleaning it and to look for any obvious problems. So this is the power amplifier board. Again, I don't need to look in a manual to figure that out because it's got these big old heat sinks and of course these big power transistors. Let's see what those are. Interesting, Marantz branded power transistors. And I'm not familiar with Marantz equipment. This is the first one I've had, and therefore the first one I've looked inside. I haven't consulted a manual yet or any other source for figuring out what to do. This is just such a basic thing. Generally, the covers come off similar ways on all of them. The faces come off in similar ways on all of them. The Marantz is actually a little bit unusual in that it had those four bolts like that. Sort of one of their trademark kind of looks. It's a nice way to hold on a faceplate. It means the faceplate's not held on with nuts on the knobs, which is how most of them are held on. I'm looking for where I'm going to get access to the pots. I do want to treat those, each of those with DeOxIT.
I can probably get at them from above, and I don't think I'll have better access from below, but I think I will go ahead and take off the bottom cover just to see what's up. Yeah, the bottom inside looks a whole lot cleaner, which is again unsurprising because it's on the bottom. So it wouldn't have been open to gathering dust. I opened one receiver relatively recently that was stunningly clean inside. It was a Pioneer SX440, which has low enough power that it doesn't have vent holes in the case, at least not in the top, and therefore doesn't have an easy way for dust to get in. And so it was pretty near pristine on the inside, at least looked it. But that's a low power amplifier, low power receiver. It's, I think, something like 10 watts per channel. Interesting, often the feet are attached to the base plate, but not in this case. When I say often, I mean often in the receivers that I have opened up and serviced and restored. And looking pretty nice and spiffy down there. The top of the base plate had quite a bit of dust on it, but hard to say whether that is from accumulation over years or probably at least some of it just came from me dusting off the top. There are a couple of routes for dust to come down, right? It can come down through these slots in the heat sink, through the gap between the power amp board and the heat sink, and between the power amp board and the rest of the chassis. In addition to just looking out for things that might appear amiss, looking for how to gain best access to the volume and tone and balance control pots in order to treat them and clean them. Better be careful, some of that metal feels like I may have already been cut. Yeah, I have. Doesn't look like it's gonna bleed right now. Sharp metal edges in here. Frequently coming up with some mysterious little cuts here and there after handling chassis. I came up with this cut the other day and I was like, well, I was moving around some tube amp chassis, so maybe that's how that happened. As I was speculating previously, you know, or observing previously, I can't get directly at the pots this way because there's that circuit board in the way. I can get at them through here, but not sure if that's going to really be a better way to access them than from above. There's little holes in the pots that, among other things, at least let you get the nozzle for the spray in there. This thing, because those are situated on the tops of the pots, those might be better accessed from the top.
Oh,
100 times each. Slider, maybe able to go into the front. I'm not sure I'd want to use the DeOxIT on that though. I want to use the multi-purpose precision lubricant perhaps. Allow to dry at least 4 to 6 hours before energizing. Good. Maybe I'll hold off for now. When I was playing it the other day, the right channel was coming in and out and crackling. Got a little bit of crackle. So that's why I wanted to do this right away. Ultimately, I do want to replace all the electrolytic capacitors. I've even gone so far as with the Pioneer SX828 to replace all the carbon composite resistors, because the carbon composite resistors can be a bit noisier than modern metal film resistors, and they're also flammable. I'm pretty certain I want to replace the electrolytic capacitors. I'm just as certain that I want to replace a lot of these small transistors. They're cheap. A lot of the old ones are known to develop problems over time, and so it's just good practice to replace them with care, because you've got to be real careful of the pin out. Different transistors have different orders of the three legs. Just because a transistor meets the same specs as the old one doesn't mean it. You can just slot it in exactly the same legs in the same holes. When you mess that up, it can lead to problems, of course. When I restored a Pioneer SX828, I replaced all of the electrolytic capacitors, I replaced almost all of the carbon composite resistors, and I replaced many of the small transistors. And I messed up the pins on some of those transistors, and so it took me a long time to track down the source of the trouble and fix it. I now have a transistor tester that tells me what function goes on what leg. I should make it general practice to test each transistor like that with that device before putting it in, so that I'm clear on what goes where when I do so. Give this one more little blast to rinse it out. Now, there are a lot of switches too. You don't want to treat power switches with DeOxIT. Not if there are actual high voltage power switches, that is line voltage. But the other switches can be treated with DeOxIT and probably should be, although it's often quite difficult to figure out how to get any DeOxIT into those switches. I think for now I will leave them be, because I'm not seeing any obvious places to get DeOxIT in there. They're not particularly easily accessible. I may wish I had, but we'll see. Clean things before I put them back. Alright, I've cleaned things up. Cleaned the bottom plate, the top cover, the faceplate, the knobs. I guess what I haven't cleaned are these buttons, switch buttons. Now this is a stubborn one. So this has, you know, grooves. It's hard to get in there. Let me try with the toothbrush and some surface countertop cleaner. I think that should do it. Still kind of looks like hell on the inside, but it's a whole lot better than it was.
thinking perhaps I ought to see if there are lamps that need replacing and go ahead and do that while I've got things disassembled. Always easier when things are apart. And plug it in. Power it on and check the lights. There's definitely one out here. You can see the filament lit for this one. I can see the filament lit for this one. And I can see the filament lit for this one, but I think there's one more. Yeah, there's one more on the end that's out. And looks like both my dial lights are good. They look to be fuse type festoon lamps. Usually the easiest way to get to these is just through the front, take off this front piece. And then of course I will be faced with the issue of, shouldn't I go ahead and replace all of them if I'm going to replace some? And will it work to replace them with what I plan to replace them with? So let me first get this out of the way. Careful with that. Don't want to break that. Let's see, one, two screws. Could it really be that easy? Okay, so that was just this piece. Is that glass glued on there? I believe that is glued on there. All right, let's see. I'm gonna screw it back on. Let's see if there's a clear way to get at it from the back. Yeah, let's see. There's a screw there and a screw there that may let this piece come out. This screw isn't even tight. I don't know. It's loose and, shit, that's broken is what that is. Damn. It does at least make it obvious that I think if I just remove this screw, I can take off the whole light panel here. Yep. I hate plastic in these things. It just doesn't last. Or yellows and gets brittle and... So I just took this screw out here. It was attached to these, you know, holding this metal piece against these two pieces of this prong, this fork, plastic fork, basically. And then the partner of it is over here, but the pieces are broken off. So again, these are these fuse type or festoon type lamps. So these are vintage incandescents right here. If I want to keep it incandescent, at least for now, I could use these, maybe. Assuming they're the right voltage and all that. 8 volt, that's good. Okay, I'm pretty sure these are also 8 volt. Yeah. So ultimately, I may want to replace all of these with LEDs, but for now, let's leave it as original-ish. Look, it's still plugged in, so let's see. Awesome. Cable tie. I don't know if I can make that work, but it's worth a shot. Cable ties are amazingly strong and durable, and if I can get a cable tie in there without messing anything up, then it's a conservative sort of repair. I haven't done anything irreversible like epoxy would be. The question is there anything for this to grab onto? There's nothing else for it to, you know, I can wrap it around the screw here, but there's nothing else to wrap it around there, but then that's going to interfere with the string. It's pretty tight without actually being fastened. Just clip it off and call it good, see if it lasts. That's actually holding it pretty tight. I'm just going to go with that. Yeah, I was worried that it was going to be stopping the dial thing, but the dial stopped before that point. Cool. It wasn't looking nearly as pretty as I'd hoped it would. Thank you. thing that makes me nervous about aluminum is you just want to be so careful not to over tighten it, because threads are just that much more fragile than steel. So. Okay, I'm stopping there. It should be tight enough. Well, I think that looks pretty nice. Let's see what it looks like with the power on. Very nice, very nice.
We're going to do some testing of this Marantz 2252 that I just finished cleaning up. A record here, who? Quadrophenia. This work for the sound, but also for the look. And it is really a very nice look. Much nicer, of course, having both those new lights, or new old lights anyway. One of the features I like about this receiver is that it has one of the tape inputs selectable at the selector switch. Tape 2 is selectable here, whereas tape 1 is selectable via the monitor switch here. So I've got this tape deck plugged into tape 2.